So my name is Jeff Reed. I'm the director of the Georgetown Entrepreneurship Initiative, and we're really excited to have all of you here. We're excited about entrepreneurship at Georgetown and entrepreneurship in the DC community. This is a kind of a landmark moment for us as we culminate our first summer incubator program. And over the last two or three years, since I came to Georgetown, I've seen a huge increase in the interest and activity level of our entrepreneurial students. And over the last school year, that level of activity, people actually starting real companies, it grew to enough of a critical mass where I decided it was time for us to have this sort of an incubator program. And so back in April, we started a selection process and ultimately came up with the companies that you see here tonight who were selected as the first cohort, the first ever Startup Hoyas incubator cohort. And over the last 11 weeks, they've been working here out of this great building. They've had resources from some of our entrepreneurs in residence, and faculty members have been giving advice. We've had some alumni come in and give them some inspirational speeches, and as well as some mentoring and advising. We've had some lawyers and some technical experts come in. And then we've also had a couple of other events somewhat like this one in which they had a chance to kind of be introduced to the public. And through all that, the teams have been making a lot of progress, and tonight they're going to give you their short pitches, and you'll see kind of where they are now. Let's see. We'd love to recognize the we have a few featured investors who are here tonight who are going to be giving some feedback to the teams. The feedback is not going to be like verbal. They're not going to hammer them like you might see in a Shark Tank type format. We're going to ask our investors to write on the pages we've given them some feedback about each team. And we ask everyone here, after all the teams have made their pitches, we're going to continue the reception, and the teams will stand around by their posters, and you can go give them direct feedback. And so we really appreciate, you know, this is a chance for you to get to know them. If you see something you like here, give them some advice, give them some help, give them your business card, and say you're ready to write a check, whatever it might be. So with that, I think, Tim, anything else I need to say? All right, so I guess we're going to get this thing started. Our first company is AquaCore. You want me to do this one? All right, Tim will be introducing. I'll introduce, let me just say, Tim Reardon, wave over here. Tim has been the leader of this. He's an MBA student and a graduate assistant, and he's really been running the incubator this summer. So I'm going to turn over the podium to him after I finish this talk, and he'll manage as the teams come through. So thanks to Tim and our first company, AquaCore, Logan Soya.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. Tall guy. So right now, this building that we're in right now, your office building, and pretty much every other building in the United States is suffering from inefficiency. Over 30% of their monthly electric bill goes to complete waste. Industry experts have cited that this is a $1 billion opportunity for savings. A McKinsey report cited $170 billion could be saved, compound that problem across the United States. I want you to take a second and think about your credit card statement. You get it in the mail, you open it up, and it's $200,000. What do you do? Next thing you do, I want to know where I spent my money. I looked at to the transaction list, except, oh, the banks, they didn't give you a transaction list. $200,000 this month, no transaction list. Are you going to pay? This is a problem that small and medium-sized commercial buildings suffer every month, except it's not their credit card statement, it's their utility bill. So why is this acceptable? My name's Logan Soya. I'm the founder of AquaCore, and I'm going to tell you why AquaCore has solved this problem and how we do it better than anybody else for small and medium-sized commercial buildings. It starts with a small piece of equipment, cheap, inexpensive, that clamps onto your breaker panel. Within 2 hours, you're streaming live, real-time data about your energy consumption up to our cloud-based SaaS platform. There, we augment that data with the latest ENERGY STAR products, the latest energy statistics, and a slew of other useful information to provide you a real-time decision-making platform. What we give you is a decision-making platform that helps you find the next investment for your building and helps you save in regular operating costs of your to run your building. I want you to think of us like Opower, except we have the hardware to go to larger buildings. We're seeing great traction this summer. We've brought our product to fruition and are ready to implement a demo. We've partnered with an energy efficiency specialist in the DC area and have selected 4 pilots that we'll be implementing this month. We're also a member of the Clean Tech National Open, a national incubator for clean technology out of California. And we have an incredible team. I'd love to talk to you more about it. I'd love to talk to you more about investment as we get these pilots underway. So my name's Logan Soya. I'll be in that corner back there. And I want to shift your building into a high-performance building. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Logan. Okay, our next presenter is Todd Koper. He will present on his company, Bookend Technologies, and ties in our School of Continuing Studies.
Thank you, Tim. Actually, let's go out of this, because I am very excited tonight to show our beta product that will be launching at schools next month. So, excited about that. Hi, everyone. My name is Todd Koper. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Bookend Technology. Bookend is an early warning system that we sell to schools that is designed to help students better understand where they're falling behind and then serves up resources to help them get ahead. My mission is to put bumper stickers on everyone's car that says, "My child is an honor roll student." Everybody knows the pride that someone has in putting that sticker on their car. But how can we do this? The way we can do this is rethink the way that we look at education, and more importantly, rethink the way we look at communicating grades. For the past century and beyond, we have seen grades communicated in basically 3 ways. You have a midterm, a couple progress reports, and a final report card. And oftentimes, when you get the grade on that final report card, it's too late. You stick it under the mattress and hope mom and dad don't see it. So we want to transform that to a proactive alert system that not only shows you what's coming around the corner, but adds in the predictive component to say that says, if you keep going in this track, you're going to get a D in this class, or you're going to get an F in this class, so that you don't have to wait for the midterm or final to see that grade. We do all this while connecting the parents and the teachers. And I'll show you exactly what I mean by this. So you're looking at the interface for the parent right now. And the best story that I could tell for this is, you know, if you're a Washingtonian, you work 9 to 5, you may only have 3 hours with your child at night to focus on what's important in school, right? Typically, you ask the question, how are you doing in school? And 9 times out of 10, your child has no clue really how they're doing in school. But now, on your smartphone or on the computer, because we wrote this cross-platform to be compatible with any device, you can look up and see, okay, well, my child, here are his recent grades. Here's my son or daughter's historical performance. Here are the focus areas in which he or she may need improvement. And here are some local tutors that can help in this particular area. Again, bringing all these resources to you so that you aren't dumbfounded by the time that grade comes home and you're saying, okay, well, why'd my kid get a D? And we also do this, and let me click in here for the teacher. We also make teachers' lives easier because they're the ones who really make the difference in this equation. So the average teacher today has 5 class periods a day. The average K-12 teacher, I'm sorry, has five classes per day of 30 students each. My mother-in-law is a teacher, and actually that was one of my driving forces by creating this product, is that she has no clue in the churn of classes which students might be falling behind so that she can give that one-on-one attention to that child. If you look here, you'll see, if I'm a teacher, I get in the morning and I can say, okay, well, I'm a math teacher. My first period is statistics. I can see the recent class averages of grades. I can see the most improved student. And using analytics, I can see the focus students that might need some additional assistance that I can give one-on-one attention to. And you can click into these, and you can give you a drill-down version of each. So my background has been selling into education for the past 5 years. I've been in consulting in the trenches at Gartner Research in their EdTech vertical. I found that no one's doing this, okay? It's been my job to research this, and no one was doing it. So time I was at Gartner, I've been a big brother in the Big Brothers Big Sisters program. So I noticed what was sticking in the classroom and what was falling by the wayside. And I decided after a bunch of sleepless nights and certainly convincing my wife that this was a great idea to start Bookend in February. So I left Gartner, jumped ship. I'm actually one half of Bookend. My co-founder, Eric Miller, has been a longtime friend. He's the technical brains behind this, and I sell it to schools at an enterprise SaaS license. So we sell this annually, $5,000 a year, so we can go in directly at the purchase card level. And the school, in turn, provides that as a free service to parents and students who attend that school. We're gonna be piloting this program next month, starting out in Arlington County, and we're in final talks to get this in Southeast DC, as well as Maryland. And I like to say that if you can make it in Montgomery County, in Arlington County, it's like New York. If you make it there, you can make it anywhere. Just fighting through the educational bureaucracy that is the DC area. So we're gonna be raising money over the next couple months. If you wanna be part of the feeding frenzy that will be our angel round, please talk to me after this. And I will be happy to answer any questions. Our website is bookendtechnology.com. So please check us out, and I'll be around after this. Thanks so much, everyone.
I told my mother-in-law that she had no clue it wouldn't have gone as well as yours did. Our next presenter is Jeff Stefanis. Dash is his company.
All right, so show of hands, how many of you enjoyed your commute over to Georgetown tonight, be it by car or by public transportation? How many enjoyed their commute? And how many of you enjoyed finding a place to park in Georgetown? Show of hands. Yes, me neither. Hi, I'm Jeff Stefanis, and I am a co-founder and the CEO of Dash. We are revolutionizing personal transportation with the first electric bicycle designed specifically for the American market. Now, for those of you unfamiliar with what an electric bicycle is, or more commonly referred to as an e-bike, it's effectively a regular bicycle with a small motor and a battery attached. Now, on an e-bike, it allows you to do two things. One, pedal just like it were a normal bike, or two, turn the throttle on the handlebar and go at speeds of up to 20 miles per hour without pedaling. Now, by federal law, these are designated as regular bicycles, so you do not need a license or registration to ride one. Additionally, you can ride in bike lanes, bypassing traffic, and park on sidewalks and in front of buildings, avoiding parking hassles. Now, e-bikes aren't a new idea. They've actually changed transportation in Northern Europe and in China. In China alone last year, they sold four times as many e-bikes as cars, bringing the total number of e-bikes on Chinese roads to over 125 million. They just haven't taken off in the US yet, but we feel the time is now. In a recent study by the DC Department of Transportation, they found that 62% of commuters are not happy with their commute. Furthermore, 63% are likely to try an alternative mode of transportation in the coming year, and 51% are within e-bike range, what we define as 10 miles or less from point of origin to point of destination. Now, if you're sold on e-bikes and you want to get one, these are your current options behind you. This is a pretty run-of-the-mill e-bike for the US market. Quite frankly, it's pretty ugly and not something I'd be comfortable or confident riding. Additionally, it's $1,500. To get something sleeker and sexier, like this next one, is gonna run you closer to $3,000 or $4,000. Our bike is designed to compete directly with public transportation. Our bike will cost $1,200 and look more like the second bike than the first one. Additionally, we are the first electric bike company in the world to make the smartphone the center of the riding experience. To ride our e-bike, you don't turn a key to turn it on. You instead plug in your smartphone and type in your password. This then gives you GPS, turn-by-turn navigation, and a suite of social features that we believe will redefine what it means for a product-based company to have a social media strategy. As excited as we are about this product, we're even more excited about the team. My co-founder in the audience, Amber, raising her hand, is an absolute transportation junkie. She is the former director of marketing for Flexcar, which was Zipcar's biggest competitor, which it acquired in 2007. She also was instrumental in launching the DC Circulator, arguably the DC Department of Transportation's biggest victory in the last decade. Currently, we are designing and building our first prototype, which we expect to have ready for both you and I to ride in 4 to 6 weeks, and looking for angel investment to help us launch this fall in a pilot program. Thanks so much for coming out and supporting Georgetown Entrepreneurship, and I look forward to talking with you all afterwards.
The Eastern Shore and didn't go to college. All he's known is hunting and fishing for his entire life. So to make a living, he is a year-round guide and specializes in waterfowl hunting on the Eastern Shore. So people are basically spending $25 billion on people like Steve to take them out. There's a problem though. Steve doesn't know how to market himself properly. This creates three problems. First, the guides are very difficult to find. If you're looking for the guides on the Eastern Shore, they might all have their own websites, which don't work very well, and they're not part of one central database. Second, it's hard to find a price point for the trip. Whether you're an experienced hunter or somebody that's never been before, it's hard to grasp how much you should be paying for this trip with Steve. And then finally, there's no online resource to determine who the best guides are. Maybe Steve's terrible. There might be another person that will better fit your needs. And another problem is there are Steves all over the United States. People just like Steve who what they're passionate about is being a hunting and fishing guide, not marketing themselves. We think we have the solution for that. We want to bring them all together in one place and create an online marketing platform that gives them all a fair shot to focus on their client base. We are GuideBreeze. This is the scenario we think on how it's going to play out. A hunter from DC wants to go on a fishing trip on the Eastern Shore for waterfowl. He wants to go on a hunting trip on the Eastern Shore for waterfowl. He goes on our website and searches by his criteria. All these guides pop up. He finds a guide that he thinks is best for a price he's willing to pay. And there's our boy Steve. They're a match made in heaven. This is another day of work for Steve. And this hunter has a great experience on his trip. Now, we have a prototype, and I'm going to have Brian show you it.
So this is our basic prototype right now, and it's not currently fully functional, although we will launch the beta phase of our site in about 3 weeks. So you come to our home screen. There's a screen that's for planning a hunting trip. When you scroll over it, you'll see this will populate with a question or two. And you don't even need to fill out the question or two if you're a beginning hunter or fisherman and you don't really know what you want to do. So you can click on, you want to plan a hunting trip. It'll populate, based on the criteria you filled out, or you didn't click any criteria. it'll populate a list of the guides right here, and this will be the company names. It'll have a quick look at the guide, so this will, you know, tell you, give you a couple photos, give you a brief description of what they offer, some of their primary services, and if you like them, you can click on their full profile. On their full profile here, and this is how we're going to make our revenue. We're going to charge the guides on a subscription basis, $300 annually, as well as we'll have, our site is built out for advertising revenue. So like a Bass Pro Shops, Cabela's, Gander Mountain, or anyone who sells hunting and fishing gear in that market can advertise on our site. So you've selected a guide you like, you want to find out a little bit more about them. This will tell you where they're located, a link to their website, how long they've been a member of Guide Breeze. There's an overview if you scroll down here, kind of telling you just basically what they're all about, their pricing. We'll have a reviews built into it so you can kind of find out, you know, get testimonials and recommendations from other people who have used this guide or outfitting service before. And photos, and you can click on these photos and it'll superimpose them on the page, and as well as videos built in to the site, and they'll play automatically once they start, and also a map of where they're located down here, because you know most websites today have Google Maps integrated into them, and a lot of people enjoy that feature. And basically, we're really excited about the launch. We'll have our beta phase of our website available in 2 weeks. Kyle and I are going to swing for the fences. Basically, we're bringing technology to a market that has very little, but we think we're hitting the market at a really good time. You know, there's tons of hunting and fishing shows, even on A&E and ESPN. And you know, the technology curve is right to hit it right now, and we're really excited about it. And we'll be hanging out right there, and right now we're looking for investors in the fall so that it'll allow us to scale properly as we test our traction with our beta site. And thanks for coming out to support us.
Thanks, guys. Luke Schoenfelder is our next presenter, presenting with LET.
Good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming out. I'm excited to talk to everyone a little bit about our company, Local Energy Technology. My name's Luke Schoenfelder. I just graduated from Georgetown College this spring. And I'm going to tell you first a little bit about our team and how we found this opportunity. So our platform harnesses the power of the internet to connect utility service providers with their customers. What we found, my team is composed of myself, four engineers from RIT and MIT, an architect from Oklahoma State University. Two of us started doing energy consulting in Haiti post-earthquake for the last 2 years. And while we were there looking to expand energy technology, we ran into a lot of problems. Our company at that point was given seed funding by the Dell Social Innovation Competition. And concurrent with that, the rest of our team was actually working on a separate company providing energy solutions in Eastern Europe. So as we all sat down in this incubator last summer, we realized that we were facing common problems. And the problem was this. The electricity sector in emerging markets is really chaotic in terms of billing. So right now, in emerging market utility sectors, they lose between 75 and 25% of the energy supplied to the grid to non-payment. Massive losses. As many of you have watched in the news this week, as India's grid has really skidded to a halt, they lose approximately 50% of the energy supplied to the grid to non-payment. It's about $5 billion a year. So what we did is we really studied the problem intently. If you're looking at this graph here, you can't read it. It just looks really confusing. It is. Every one of those red lines is a failure point in the current billing process. Everything is done hand to hand. There's no efficient mailing systems in these markets. Somebody has to walk out and physically check the meter, walk back to an office, walk back to deliver a bill. The customer has to walk back to the utility office to pay. It's a mess. So what we did is we said, why is this broken? And is there a precedent for a billing system that can function in these exact same markets? We found one. So we looked at prepaid cell phones and charted that growth. Absolutely explosive. And what we found is that there was a commonality across all of these markets in the way these systems functioned. In order to access the good, people had to pay upfront, and they knew that the service was going to be reliable that they were paying for. So what we did is we've replicated that model for the electricity sector. We've done that by designing a cutting-edge smart meter that's designed specifically for these markets, tamper-proof, anti-theft, very advanced communication technology built right in, patent pending. And we built a cutting-edge management platform, web-based, to handle all this data coming in and streamline payments. This is what our system looks like. So using our system, we're able to get real-time data on customer consumption, which is then fed back to our interface. With that data, we're able to send a bill directly to a customer's cell phone, which they're able to pay directly through our interface. The real beauty of this system is we've partnered with some of the largest cell phone companies in the Caribbean, which is where we're piloting, to use the back-end services that they provide, and we're able to tag right onto their banking platform. The advantage of that is that we're able to use their vendor network to have people add credit to their utility accounts. So everywhere where you can currently pay your cell phone bill, you can now pay your energy bill. It's a big breakthrough. Our platform creates a flexible and accountable system that works in a variety of contexts. It works in conventional grid systems, microgrids, and even individual household systems to keep people payment accountable. We're super excited about the product that we've developed, and we've gotten a lot of traction over the summer as part of the incubator. We just won the NCAA Inventors Prize last week, which is a $20,000 grant for innovative technology, and we're proud to announce that we closed our first investment round on Monday. So it's been a really exciting summer here at Georgetown, and we're really excited to talk with some of the people here today about potential partnership opportunities and long-term funding needs for scaling our business internationally. Thanks so much for your time, and I look forward to talking to all of you after the presentation. Thank you so much.
Okay, next up is Patrick Dowd with the Millennial Trains Project.
Thanks very much. Good evening, everybody. My name is Patrick Dowd. I'm the founder and CEO of the Millennial Trains Project. Over the course of the next year, we're going to be running a series of transcontinental train journeys across the United States with really exceptional young people, millennials on board from all different regions of the country. And the purpose of these trains is to get America back on track, both literally and figuratively, by reimagining what we can do as a country over the course of the next 10 years and reconnecting with a time in American history when people physically came together to engage in the arduous work of nation building and succeeded. What we're really trying to do here is transform the millennial generation's innate optimism into meaningful action. For the first time in American history, a plurality of people believe that the next generation is going to have it worse off than the preceding generation. And yet millennials, age 18 to 32, remain optimistic about the future and more committed than any other generation in contemporary America to bridging the gap between where we are and where we want to be as a country. And at a time, speaking of millennials, when so much of our interaction is mediated by digital technology, we feel that the importance of physically coming together to think about where do we go from here is at a higher premium than ever before. And that's why we're taking to the rails over the course of the next year along these three transcontinental routes, at the conclusion of which we'll host a summit where the participants from the prior journeys who now have a shared experience of having gone across our country with a critical eye as to what's working and what's possible in different localities around the country will come together to set priorities for where we go from here as a generation. The inspiration for this project comes from India, where I helped lead a similar train journey last year as a Fulbright scholar. And over the course of the last 10 years that this train journey's been operating in India, it's become a really big sensation, to the point where something like 20,000 young Indians now apply for 400 spots on this train every year. We're working to replicate this model here in the United States and make it even better. Our business model is a nonprofit with a positive civic return on investment. We have impact in three areas. The first is on the train, which we see as a mobile leadership development lab, where we're exposing high potential transformational young leaders to a trans-regional perspective of the major challenges and opportunities facing our country. The second area we have impact is in the communities where our trains are stopping, where we're going to be securing commitments from people in those localities for how they can drive forward progress locally. And the third is on the level of national inspiration, where we're really going to be leveraging the spectacle inherent in our activity to help establish a counter-narrative to declinist attitudes and viewpoints about where our country is headed. Over the course of the last 7 months since I quit my job at JP Morgan's investment bank to start this project, we've brought together a group of really excellent partners to bring the credibility to the project that it needs to succeed and be executed perfectly or as good as possible in every single area. Having done this and also raised seed funding from the founder of TPG Asia, we're now looking for an anchor investor, which can be a corporation, foundation, or individual whose values align with the enterprising and civic-minded values of this project. For our first train journey, we're looking to raise between $1.2 and $1.4 million, which is what we need to underwrite the train journeys. And that's the stage of our fundraising that we're at currently. I thank you all for being here today and would welcome your engagement with the project. We really want this, at the end of the day, to be a testament to our generation's ability to build unusual coalitions that enable us to accomplish big things. And that requires the help and input of a lot of people. Your help and input is most welcome. And I look forward to speaking with you about the project later. Thank you.
David Dietz is our next presenter with Motivanti.
Hi there, good evening. My name is David Dietz, and I am the founder of Motivanti. What we wear is a defining part of who we are, what we believe, and how we represent ourselves. Whole Foods provides organic and locally sourced produce. Lexus and Mercedes make hybrid cars to help us reduce our carbon footprints. There's no recognized destination for sustainable fashion until now. Introducing Motivanti, which will come next month. I'd like to introduce my company Motivanti, which will be an online marketplace for high-end sustainable fashion. Motivanti was created out of the recognized need for a site where the increasing number of socially conscious fashionistas can turn to find clothes that fit their values without sacrificing on style. A recent number of my fellow Generation Y consumers considered environmental or social impacts, or social causes, before making a purchase 60% of the time. This group is the most active consumer base in online shopping today. Like many of you, I care about environment, and I try to do my part. I shop locally, I go to organic markets, and I ride public transport, which in New York is pretty easy. But that awareness hasn't really translated to fashion, because until now there's been a divide between what is considered eco-fashion, which has had the negative stereotype of being crunchier granola, and high fashion. And when it comes to picking my clothes, there's just no way you're gonna get me to wear that. because at the end of the day, looking good will always take precedent. And while this is a hemp shirt, and hemp is water efficient, and it's eco-friendly, I want to look good over this. But being socially conscious is important. And what if choosing between eco-friendly clothing and high-end fashion was like a false premise? What if you could have both? What if instead of this hemp shirt, you could have these heels or this dress? And what if I told you these heels were designed by famed Italian luxury shoe designer Manolo Blahnik, and they're made from sustainable fish skin, fish leather, and all natural cork? And that what if I told you that this dress, or one like it, was worn by Scarlett Johansson on a red carpet, and it was created from a silk that was chemical free, that was made of sour milk? That's right, Scarlett Johansson wore a dress made of sour milk on the red carpet. Cool, right? Creating awareness about and access to high-end, trendy, sustainable fashion is a driving force behind Motivanti. We want to be the recognized destination for the socially conscious fashionista to come and shop for the latest new sustainable brands, to share her favorite curations from our site with friends on the site as well, and to learn about the advances and the newest trends in sustainable fashion. Most importantly, we want you to feel good about what you're wearing, and look great wearing it. Using our sustainable badge system, which is unique to our site, you can find what you're looking for. If you're looking for organic cotton, you can find it. If you're a vegan, we have vegan stuff. If you're concerned about fairly traded, we have it. If you're a big recycler, you can find it. If you care about, you know, our dwindling resources, we have jeans that are energy efficient. And if you want, like, bringing jobs back to the USA, we have designers that are made in USA. Of course, if you just want to be fashionable, we have that too. That's Motivanti. So we're, like I said, we're launching next month, and we are about high style for a higher purpose. And we hope you will come to our site and join us as we try to move fashion forward. Thank you very much. And right now, as I said, we're a month away, and we're looking for a strategic investment to help us add talent to our tech team, as well as to help us partner with third-party back-end systems to make shipping and returns more streamlined. Thank you very much.
Christina Lila Wilson is our next presenter with Modify.
Hi, everyone. I'm Christina Wilson. I'm here with Modify. It's a very simple concept. We are trying to democratize fashion, a website that will allow amateurs to participate in the design, voting, and feedback stages of the industry. What this does is it lowers barriers to entry so that anyone can participate. For most of human history, clothing was something much more than what you picked off a rack. It was, you were involved personally in selecting the fabric, the cut, the feel. And while it may sound like a chore, it also meant that clothing reflected your personality and your taste much more than it does today. Since then, of course, things have become much more impersonal. A top-down process essentially dictates what's available, and we can only passively choose between these options. If you do have a great concept, this is part of the journey that you would have to take to actualize your idea. So, and at the same time, we're seeing that people are really craving creative engagement once again. Online creative forums are full of participation. We know diverse people create better ideas, and amateurs are already the tastemakers of the fashion industry. But the fashion industry has not adapted to this. It has not allowed avenues of engagement for young girls. And that brings us to Modify, and what we are trying to do is to transform passive consumers into active participants in the industry, where you could get your concepts down and submit them to our website, have a page featuring your designs. And if you don't feel creatively inclined, you can also vote, vote for what we produce, and then we manufacture the highest votes. This culminates in a holistic experience of shopping where everything is created by amateurs and people feel a strong connection also with the brand. So what we need now is we need funding so that we can grow and build a website. And I will be over there.
Maxim Wheatley is our next presenter from Real Deal.
I just have to quickly connect my computer, so talk amongst yourselves. So while this boots up, I'm just going to tell you a bit about myself. So I am entering my senior year in Georgetown College, and Real Deal is my third venture and hopefully my third success. So what Real Deal... It took a minute last time. So in any case, in case this doesn't work, I'll just start out anyway. So Real Deal is basically a business service that provides brick-and-mortar businesses with a streamlined way of conducting consumer research and offering coupons, and it's entirely mobile-based, which connects it to the... Okay, this isn't working. All right, so I had a cool demo to show you, but that's not going to work. Okay, so I'll restart because this is a disaster. All right.
Let's go to mine. I think I might have it on my computer.
Oh, I have a video. That won't work, so I'll just go. I'll just do like this. And then you can stop by after this, and I'll show you the demonstration. So it's a business service that allows for brick-and-mortar businesses to conduct consumer research and offer coupons. And because it's mobile-based, it connects these businesses to consumers in a way that's very easy and nearly constantly ubiquitous. So how does it work? It uses an application that's consumer-facing, which allows for consumers to go to one place and access any coupons that have already been demographically specified for them. In return for completing a very brief survey, they get immediate access to a QR-held coupon, which they can redeem immediately. So what this really means is that the consumer is able to get something that's immediately gratifying essentially it's just real time, and it allows for them to get things immediately instead of the traditional method where surveys are taken many, many hours after a purchase and the reward is also very delayed, and therefore it doesn't encourage proper participation. Real Deal also works to make things more social and more personalized. Because the client can demographically specify how they would like to do things, including which demographics they would like to work with, what questions they'd like to ask those demographics, as well as what rewards they'd like to offer, they can make it more tailored to their target market. This is good because as well as making the research better on the client end, on the consumer end, it makes things far more relevant and interesting to them, and therefore more likely to actually engage properly, improving the quality of the overall research. It's all powered through Real Deal's central website, which allows for the client to build their surveys, customize the promotions they want to offer, as well as specify the target market that they would like to engage. Because those three factors are all completely non-exclusive, it opens up tons of possibilities for businesses to determine when they want to do their research, to whom they want to give it to, the questions they want to ask them, and the promotions they'd like to offer. So overall, it provides real-time and very local research that's constantly relevant, allowing for businesses of all sizes to improve in any area that they would like to. To the businesses, it brings them the benefit of addressing and finding small issues that they may not have identified previously, while also running in a completely autonomous way. For the consumers, it gives them a simple place to find all of the coupons and deals that are in their immediate vicinity and that are already going to be relevant to them. And that's it, and I'm sorry that this didn't work.
Okay, we're a little more than halfway done. And before we move on to our next presenter, I was wondering if we might just first acknowledge our featured investors for being here today. I didn't do that to begin with. John Bacchus is here from New Atlantic Ventures, John Burke from True Ventures, Alan Gannett from Acceleprise, Jim Hunt from Blue Ventures, Yaniv Suisa from NEA, and Julia Taxson from GrowTech. Would you mind standing so we can all see you? Thank you. Okay, Mitch Harris is our next presenter with Reserved Incorporated.
Thanks, Sim. Good evening, everyone. My name is Mitchell Harris, and I am a co-founder of Reserved. Reserved gives people an opportunity to buy table reservations at popular restaurants up to the last minute. And we've all had a situation in the past, right, where we wanted to eat at a nice restaurant at the last minute and have been unable to secure a reservation, right? Whether that's a special occasion, right, your anniversary, Valentine's Day, you want to take your special someone out to eat somewhere nice, maybe impress them. If your friends are in town and you guys want to go to, you know, Spanish tapas, you want to go to like Estadio on 14th Street on Saturday at 8 p.m., tough to get a reservation. I actually had a situation a couple months ago where I accidentally stood my girlfriend up. We were supposed to go on a date, right? I was supposed to go meet her at the movies and accidentally left her there by herself because I was working too late. And she was pissed. So I had about 24 hours, 48 hours to make up for this. I figured I want to take her to one of her favorite restaurants. I wanted to go to Comey or to Bourbon Steak. Couldn't get a reservation. I would have paid a small fortune at this time to be able to get a reservation. Reserved is the solution to this problem. Now, what we do as Reserved is we make reservations, okay, at popular restaurants, popular times, months and months in advance. Then we upload those at the right time to our online auction platform, okay, which allows consumers to easily search for reservations, the date, the time, party size, etc. And then they can buy or bid on the reservation of their choice. Now, importantly, we don't share revenue with restaurants. And this is largely based on feedback from restaurants and that they think that a revenue sharing agreement in this case might endanger the customer service expectations from their diners. However, we do donate from every winning bid, a portion of our revenue from every winning bid, to help fight child hunger. Reserved is the ultimate solution for last minute reservations at nice restaurants. We're currently in development phase. We plan to launch our prototype here in DC first this fall. We're really excited about that. We're also always looking for potential advisors to help us as we develop and grow our business. Especially if you have experience in the restaurant or service industries or in the e-commerce space. And then lastly, please visit our website and join our mailing list. We'll keep you posted. We're at reservedinc.com and follow us on Facebook and Twitter. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mitch. Our next presenter, Ian Simpson from T-Volution, is not here tonight. He has a wonderful product, great company. His wife is very pregnant, and he couldn't take a chance of missing, so he's not here. And we will we'll move to Tutela. Paul Singh.
Good afternoon. Hello. All right. Good afternoon. My name is Paul Singh. I'm a recent graduate, MBA graduate from Georgetown University. I'm also the founder of Tutela. Tutela is an open media platform that empowers people to tell their perspective of the stories that make up our world. In the aftermath of the 2005 London bombings, former FCC chairman Michael Powell said the most significant pictures he had seen were not from professional photographers. They were from witnesses at the scene using their personal cell phones and their digital cameras. In fact, he noted that when people experience a tragedy, they're able to convey what actually happened while at the same time expressing deep emotion and engaging in spirited storytelling. That by looking at those pictures and hearing those stories, he felt like he was there. Now, our world is made up of stories, stories about people, places, events. But until now, the internet has only shown us pieces of these stories. We see pieces on Twitter, Tumblr, Facebook, CNN, New York Times, but rarely do we get to see the whole story in one place. To tell it changes it. To tell a story. That's how we got our name. You see, we're all part of a story. And now with everyone carrying cell phones and cameras and iPads, we have the ability and the opportunity to document our perspective, our piece of that story. With Tutela, Tutela provides a way to bring all those pieces together through pictures and videos in one place. With Tutela, you can see the whole story. Now imagine that every story had a place where it could be shared, that everyone could contribute to that story openly. That's our storyboard. Topics can be vast movements like the Egyptian or the Syrian revolution, or something local or personal like your best friend's wedding. But with Tutela, you get to see the Egyptian revolution through the eyes of people that were marching on Tahrir Square. You have people all over the country, even the world, bound by this one topic, sharing their perspective, their piece of the story. So tonight, I'm here to give you a little sneak peek at Tutela. We are angel-funded, so we have been able to build the platform. The system, as you can see, it pulls the pictures out of the story, and it creates a collage. Pictures that are liked more bubble to the top. Pictures that are liked less start sinking to the bottom. Let's see if we can. So if there's a story that you want to see more of, you can click on it. The story details page pops up, and you can see it in greater detail. But the collage itself is very visually stimulating and striking. But it's not the most important thing about it. I think the most important thing is the fact that you're getting people that are for the revolution, against the revolution, that don't know about the revolution, and their perspectives on the topic together in one place. There's a conversation that's happening on this board. And that's the value proposition. You're creating a feedback loop in pictures and videos. And that's very striking. So we are here tonight looking for investors. Feel free to come and talk to me. I can explain to you the vision and the business model. This is a traffic play. So we see commercialization opportunities down the road. And thank you very much.
Kathleen Wolf is our next presenter with Touchdome LLC.
Hi, everybody. Kathleen Wolf here, Touchdome LLC. Touchdome is a new audio wristwatch. It announces the time when you press on the face of the watch. Now, that's a novelty and a watch for everybody, but it's going to be especially useful for the 22.5 million people in the United States today who have low vision to the point where they experience difficulty in their daily activities. So these kinds of watches, audio watches, are not well known to the general public, but they are very well known to people who have vision loss. About 500,000 of them are sold every year, and that's an excellent adoption rate, and that's despite some serious quality issues. I learned about the poor quality of these watches when a friend of mine lost his vision in a struggle with cancer. I bought him one of these watches, but unfortunately, it broke within a matter of days. And then when we tried to take it to have the battery fixed, the battery cost more than the watch itself. It had many issues, and the Touchdome watch is going to solve those issues. One second. So this is a Touchdome watch. That's the women's version of it. And the Touchdome watch goes one better. It solves more than quality issues. My friend, before the watch broke, he also had some hesitation to use it in public because the watch would announce the time to everyone around him, which, as you can imagine, is pretty awkward. So the Touchdome watch, press the face of it, and it announces the time. And you turn the bezel on the watch, and it adjusts the volume. No watch out there has volume control. And so that's actually a really important feature to the consumer. So the rotating bezel allows for the volume control. And we've also discovered another important consumer insight. And, you know, we can all appreciate how low quality would bother any consumer. But consumers also told us that they don't like the look of these watches. The watches that are on the market today are particularly unattractive.
And even people who have low vision or people who are completely blind know this, and it's no secret. So we distributed a survey with the help of the National Federation of the Blind to 5,000 people. And style was one of the most desired features, along with volume control, water resistance, and also ease of programming. So the style of the Touch Dome watch has been designed by a top European watch designer who will also be our product developer. And it's the first high fashion audio wristwatch. In addition to that, Touch Dome has other competitive advantages, including the Touch Dome team. We're working with not only Mr. Fournier of Horology Design, but also a biomedical engineer who is now manufacturing a health and heart monitoring watch, a woman who's been in retail for 30 years with assisted living devices, and a web designer who specializes in medical device animation. So that is our watch, and that is our overall innovation. As for IP protection, TouchDome has a utility patent pending. We now have a good handle on our cost of production so that we know that we are going to have a net margin better than 50%. And overall, we are just ideally positioned to capitalize on the demand for products that assist with age-related vision loss. And as many of you may know, the number of people in the country over the age of 65 will double by the year 2030. So we need $450,000 for our seed round. Of that, $200,000 has been raised. So we need another $250,000 to fill out the round. I'm right over here at that station. I have a cosmetic prototype. Doesn't have the electronics, but it'll tell you the look, the feel, and generally the size of the Touch Dome Sidekick watch. Welcome to let you try it on, and I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Next up is Andreas Shambalidis from Tutors on Campus.
Thanks, Tim. Excuse me. Hi, I'm Andreas, one of the founders of Tutors on Campus, a tutoring company that connects undergraduates looking to supplement their education with graduates aiming to sharpen their skills while earning some extra income. One of my students the other day came to me and told me a little bit about his college experience before he encounter Tutors on Campus. So it's a couple weeks into his freshman year, and John has his physics exam coming up. He decides to go through the traditional routes and find a tutor. First, he goes to the Academic Resource Center. There, he finds a peer tutor who barely knows the material. After that, he goes to Craigslist, where he sees a bunch of seemingly qualified applicants, but there's really no way to vet them. So he decides against it and decides to study solo, thus earning himself a big fat D. So we're here for kids like John, and we're here for kids like anyone else who really needs a tutor. Our services currently include online booking, online payment, and the ability to browse through hundreds of qualified tutor resumes. We currently recruit for three tutor competencies: expertise, communication skills, and organizational skills. Then we match tutors and students through personality traits, learning styles, and teaching styles. We're currently in the Washington, D.C. area, and within the past 9 months of business, we've generated over $70,000 worth of revenue and $40,000 worth of profit. In that, we've billed over 2,200 hours. We currently plan to expand to Los Angeles and Maryland by the fall. And with that, we're looking for qualified investors and mentors to lead us throughout the 50 states and build our brand accordingly. Thank you.
Andreas. Next up is Josh and Gabe Payton of Yellow Flag.
How's it going? My name is Gabe Payton. I'm a co-founder and president of Yellow Flag. Yellow Flag is the world's first social network designated for college and pro football. It's Facebook for football meets the speed of texting. The economic impact of football in our country is $24 billion. There's 75 million college fans and about 90 million NFL fans. In Tuscaloosa, Alabama, the population is about 91,000 people. That population balloons up to about 270,000 people on game day. The stadium only holds 100,000 people. That means there's 170,000 people that don't even go to the games. Why is tailgating so popular? It's social, real-time conversations. But what if you can't be there? Well, that's what we provide. Yellow Flag is a virtual tailgate from anywhere in the world. We looked at the way people communicate during games, and we found that 87% of people text message during football games, followed by Facebook and Twitter. Thanks. The problem we found with these ways to message is that texting is not social, Facebook is not real time or it's slow, and Twitter is not a conversation. So what we did was we designed a patent-pending technology, our communication tool, that is fully social, it's lightning fast, and it provides rich conversations, just like you would if you were at a tailgate. And I'm gonna let Josh tell y'all how we're gonna make the money.
That's pretty important. All right, so our users come to Yellow Flag and they sign up. And when they download Yellow Flag, they're gonna pick some of their favorite teams. They're gonna pick their favorite college team, and then they're gonna pick their favorite NFL team. And then Yellow Flag is gonna connect those users to football fans across the country. And as as we increase our user base, we're going to monetize with advertisements, we're going to monetize with in-app partnerships, and then we're going to provide syndicated APIs that we're going to license to our strategic partners. So in order to distribute our product as lean as possible, we went out and we recruited 25 interns from some of the biggest schools across the country. Some of those schools include Georgia, University of Florida, University of Oklahoma. And they have a reach of about 2.1 million people. Additionally, we are in late stage negotiations with the Military Bowl to be their exclusive app this year. And when we finish that deal, they're going to provide us with $150,000 in marketing and advertising budget to market this year. So we're going to launch Yellow Flag 1.0 the 28th of August. We're going to have a launch party at Crystal City Sports Pub. It is the number one sports pub in the DMV area, so we'd like to invite you guys to join us. And we're also looking for seed round investments and corporate sponsors and strategic partners that might be a good fit for us. So we've got a really well-rounded team. You can see some of the schools that are represented up there. Our strengths are technology and business. And if you feel that you would like to be a part of our team, either from a strategic partnership aspect or from an investor aspect, we'd like to talk to you after our speech today. So thank you for having us.
Next up is Eric Bell with Yo Bucko.
Let's see here. All right, we'll end this thing well. So my name is Eric Bell. I'm the president and CEO of Yo Bucko. Might as well. Yo Bucko is a personal finance site for young adults, people in their 20s, Generation Y. There's 75 million young adults in that age range, and they're facing a lot of financial distress right now. The average college student graduates with about $23,000 in student loans. They have about $4,100 in credit card debt, and not any of them have ever taken a class in personal finance. and they don't have parents that came from wealth or they didn't come from wealth themselves, it's a good chance they didn't sit around the dinner table at night talking to their parents about how to manage money. And so they get thrust out into the real world and they really don't have a financial advisor. Unless they're willing to pay a fee-only financial planner $150 an hour, or if they have $100,000 in investable assets, financial advisors just really won't talk to young people. There are people that will help you, but sometimes young people just don't know where to turn for help. So we created a platform called YoBucko. We launched it last November. We have about 10,000 unique visitors that come to our site every month. We have about 3,000 monthly newsletter subscribers. And now we're kind of hitting a point where we're like, how do we scale this business? How do we take what's really a content-driven website and turn that into a real business? So we've got kind of two solutions. We have YoBucko, which is the consumer-facing website. You can go there and you find articles, videos, step-by-step guides helping you walk through basic financial decisions. You can learn how to buy a house. You can shop for credit cards. You can find bank accounts. You can learn how to create a budget. In fact, we had 2,500 people create their first budget through YoBucko. So we're really making a difference right now. But we also were wondering, how do we get that out to the next level? Well, we came up with this idea called Buck You. Buck You is going to be a way that we're going to kind of, you know, private label, and we're going to have a white label platform for colleges and universities, partner up with MBA programs, graduate programs, and have them pay us a subscription fee each month to get the content that we have in a suite of financial management software that we're developing. My team right now is myself, who does all the content promotion and a lot of the work, and my friend Oliver Jensen, who's a developer at Google. Oliver also started his own site, but he is just he's just a fantastic developer helping me out. We also have the founder of cardratings.com, and he runs the Arkansas Angel Investors, where it's my home state. He's helping us really get the word out, helping us get a lot of the press that we've gotten. At this point, we have had some good traction. You know, we're really trying to drive traffic for the business. We do have that 10,000 unique number that we wanted to hit. That was one milestone we wanted to get to. We raised about $100,000 about a year ago from friends and family. We're now trying to get to that next level. We want to get people that are signed up, that we're constantly communicating with, getting back to. We also want to, you know, drive as many page views as we can. So a couple ways that we're doing that is we take the content that's on YoBucko, and I've started to launch a series of other websites. We have BillSnapper.com, Troop Advisor, focused on helping troops returning home from overseas. We have What a Budget. We've got Money Bugger, Bug You About Paying Your Bills. We're launching different brands through YoBucko. It's really a financial education company. Then we have Buck You, where I said it is a private label platform for colleges and universities. There's a suite of tools that students will have. We syndicate the content that we create on YoBucko through to this website, as we do on the other sites, and repurpose the content that we have. So our plan is to build out the team. I really do need some help on editorial side. I spend a lot of my time writing articles, developing content, when really I need to be out promoting the site. Like, if I can get into Time Magazine, if I can get into the press, that's where traffic is coming from right now, and so I need to be spending my time out there. There's not a Susie Orman for young people, right? Maybe I could be that guy. So that's I might not be, you know, not a fair comparison entirely, but at the end of the day, I need to be out there. Like, this is a topic that I know, it's a topic I love, and it's something that I understand. And there's people that are calling me and writing me every day asking me, Eric, what do I do in this situation? How do I get through this hurdle in my life? And we're here to help them, but I need a team to help me out. So if we are going to raise money, it is to hire an editorial staff. It's to launch the Buck You product. Oliver's working on it right now, but we will need people to help us refine and tweak that project. And, you know, we're going to be launching these multiple verticals. Over the next couple years, our plan is to exit. We had an acquisition offer 2 weeks ago that we actually turned down because it just wasn't an offer that we thought made a lot of sense. But we have seen people like Bankrate.com that are very interested. We are kind of a vertical that they want to get into, a demographic that they like to go after. Those are the people that are helping us monetize our traffic right now. We have Bankrate, Quinn Street. The people that really are suppliers are the people that I want to buy us in the next couple of years. So if you're interested in getting involved,
I can give you a pretty good deal. So just come talk to me, and I'll be in the corner drinking beer. So thank you very much.
Our last presenter tonight is Keita McCord and Becky Cranston with Give Social.
Good evening. Thank you all for being here. I'm Keita McCord, founder of Give Social, where we connect local businesses and nonprofits to improve their communities. I spent several years in the nonprofit sector, and I've noticed increasingly that nonprofits are looking for local businesses to help them achieve their missions. I spent the last 2 years in this building getting my MBA here at Georgetown and studying corporate social responsibility and how businesses are using it to achieve their mission. But I noticed some inefficiencies in the traditional ways that nonprofits and businesses connect. Often, nonprofits make call after call to local businesses to seek their sponsorship for their projects and events. And they don't always have the time to do this. On the flip side, local businesses receive request after request, and they don't have the time or capacity to filter these requests. So I worked with a team of four MBAs. Becky Cranston is here tonight. And we investigated this to try to come up with a more efficient system. And our award-winning concept is Give Social, which is a matchmaking service to connect local nonprofits that seek sponsors for their projects and events, and local businesses that are looking for meaningful ways to engage in their communities. I have seen the need for something like Give Social firsthand. Last summer, I worked at Life Pieces to Masterpieces, one of DC's most impactful nonprofits, on their corporate partnership strategy. And they have some of the most unique and exciting opportunities for business engagement, and they do a very good job of securing partnerships with local companies. But they're a very small nonprofit, and they don't have the capacity to reach out to the more than 100,000 small businesses in DC to find the match that makes the most sense for them. And also to find the organization that's able at the right time to give the resources, financial, in-kind, or volunteer support when Give Social needs it, when Life Pieces needs it most. And there are businesses that are looking for these opportunities at the right time. Companies increasingly are using corporate social responsibility and cause-related marketing to cultivate goodwill in their communities. And employees and customers are increasingly saying that they're looking to work for businesses or shop at businesses that give back. I talked to a CEO recently of a small company who said, "We're not a large corporation. We really want to give back, but we don't have the capacity for a whole CSR team to find the opportunities that work best for us. If you could bring us those opportunities, that would be of tremendous value." And this CEO and many others like him are looking for project-based approaches, so not only they, but their employees and the public can literally see the difference that they're making in their community. So at Give Social, we're solving this problem by creating a comprehensive listing of local initiatives that nonprofits seek support for. Businesses can search this listing on our website, which will launch later this month. And we're using a freemium approach, whereas local nonprofits can list their projects for free, and businesses can search for free. But we've also found that businesses, like my friend, the CEO, are looking for a more comprehensive approach. And so we'll offer a fee-based model where we can effectively be a contracted CSR for them to determine which initiatives in the community make the most sense for not only their mission, but the nonprofit's mission to further their corporate and philanthropic goals. So tonight, what we're really looking for is business partners. If you or someone you know is a small business that's struggling with figuring out the best opportunities to engage in their community, we'd love to talk to you. We'd love to work with you to develop Give Social to be the best it can be, so our communities can be the best they can be. So together, we can build local with Give Social. Thank you.
Let's hear it for all these entrepreneurs. All right. I'd like to thank all of our students and alumni and these entrepreneurs for all the work they've done this summer. What a great job. I hope you guys are as excited as I am about the future of our country when you see these kind of presentations. These are real businesses. These folks spent their summer. We did not give them any money. I didn't mention that earlier. This is one of those incubators where these folks essentially dedicated their entire summer to working on their companies. And so I think you're going to see some really, really exciting things in the future. I'd like to thank a few more people who have who've helped us tonight and helped us throughout the summer. I'd like to thank David Ross, who's here tonight, and Alyssa Lovegrove, some of our entrepreneurs and residents who've been advisors to the teams. Thank Megan Roman for helping us put some of this together. Once again, I'd like to thank our featured investors, John, Alan, Jim, Yanev, and Julia. Thank you guys very, very much. Let's see. I'd like to once again thank Tim Reardon, who really did all the work this summer. And what you've seen here, this is part of a movement. You know, it's fun to see in Washington, D.C. and at Georgetown University this growing interest in entrepreneurship. What we have are more and more people who realize that they don't have to go get a job. They can create their own job. And they don't have to just be part of the system. They can create their own system. And they're solving problems. As you heard tonight, some of these folks are looking at really, really big problems and figuring out ways that they can fix them. And that's what entrepreneurship is all about. Georgetown University is a great school. We have amazing students, and we want to be, and we already are, part of this movement that you see in Washington, D.C. for more and more entrepreneurial spirit. So we thank everyone here for being a part of that. Please stick around. The bar's open. The food is still here. The students are going to be, the entrepreneurs are going to be around at their places. Mark your calendars for November 9th. This is when our next big event will be. We have a lot of stuff all year round, but November 9th is Georgetown's Entrepreneurship Day. You'll hear more about that later. And once again, just like to congratulate all of these entrepreneurs on what they've done so far, and we can't wait to see what they do next. Thanks, everybody, for being here tonight. See you soon.